much for coming, and I didn't expect so many people today. And I'm going to tell about Baroque articulation.
Can you speak some of the other?
Yeah, I will try.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe you should come a bit closer.
My name is Olga Ivashenkova. I came from Moscow, and I have been working at Moscow Tchaikovsky Conservatory during 20 years, both flutes, baroque and modern. So I decided to present you my baroque flute knowledges and how I use it on the modern flute. A lot of my students came here too, and they are here. Every year take part in Dutch international competitions and got prizes sometimes. it doesn't matter, but maybe it's interesting to know something. So I studied in Leipzig Musikhochschule Baroque performance, and I play in Baroque orchestra in Moscow. Only one Baroque orchestra in Moscow we have. Pratt Integrum, and in different baroque ensembles. First of all, when I studied baroque flute, I liked very much baroque flute, and I played all pieces only on baroque flute. But then I returned to modern flute, and I understood that it's also all this baroque articulation works very well on the modern flute too. And because I teach a lot, and I noticed that people don't know about this articulation. It's not a common thing. And I'm going to tell how this baroque articulation influences on the phrasing and emotions and expression of baroque music in the modern world. Sorry for my. This is my first experience. I use a computer. I'm going to play too, and I will play on both flutes. And if you have questions, just ask during the lecture, and you can try this flute after the lecture and ask questions after.
What are the big differences between modern flute and traditional?
Yeah, I think
they will come in the next hour, I think. But
yeah, you see, it is very different. It is from wood. It can be also made from wood. But the main difference is that this flute doesn't have keys. And it made a conical form shape. So it's sitting here and sitting here. And Bjorn did this flute in the 19th century, and this flute is not conical, it's just straight. And it sounds different. Not only because of material, but because of the shape technology. And this flute will be half tone lower than this because it's 415.
Can't quite understand what you're saying, sorry.
Yeah, this is 415 pitch, so one half of tone. Yes. Maybe my terms are not clear. Mm-hmm. I mostly speak Russian.
415.
But your English is perfect, and maybe you can speak up because of the noise there.
I will try.
this is going to be nice though.
I should find it. And we all, I think you all use this usual articulation T, yeah? Or I tell T because of Vance wrote. A big school, I didn't bring it here, it's a sick book about how to play the flute. Mm-hmm. He wrote it in the 18th century, and he liked very much syllable T. Other flutist wrote also treatises, and this is Jacques Martin Pototel. He wrote also the book. It's much smaller, and he is supposed to pronounce two, but ones like T, D, R, and others. It was a lot of translations. It was also do, ro. It depended from the language and from the region where it was played. So we will start with T and D. It was common articulation. So all music was played with these two syllables, T and D. T is more short, more hard, and it was used for short notes, for limbs, for staccato notes, on the notes on the same pitch and repeated notes, and for stepwise motion in slow movements and in allegro movements too. For example, it is from Klein's book, how he used it. Maybe I will show it on both flutes. To the palate, but in other treatises and more later treatises, for example, Michel Corrette's book, which was he's supposed to strike the tongue opposite lips hole, and interesting that later in modern already Marcel Moïse even supposed it between the lips. Sometimes we use it when we have very strong staccato. And we don't call it staccato, it's just notes which are separate. To define fully in words either the difference between T or D, upon which a considerable part of the expressions of the patients depends. Just as there are various shades between black and white, there is more than one intermediate degree between a firm and a gentle tone stroke. So between T and D can be a lot of variations of our articulation. The main goal of this different articulation is to make music more speaking, more like human speech. It was the main idea. And we all think that it's very important to slur notes. And when we talk about baroque articulation, all people ask which slur do I must I use here, but it's not about slurs. Music was not slurred at all. In many pieces you will notice in original texts, there are no slurs at all, very few of them. I will show how we.
So that wasn't just a problem of printing. Like, I just thought they just didn't print it because you could choose yourself.
Yeah.
Or maybe it was difficult at that time to.
Yeah, but they used it much less than we see.
Uh-huh.
And not long patterns were slurred. Only a short one, only 1 minute or half of it.
Okay.
Never
so
more
than slurred.
Never. 8/16 were slurred very seldom.
Okay.
Yeah, only 4 maximum.
Okay.
Between that could be slurred. You see, I'm just. All your sheets too. This is Alemán from G major suite by 42. And you see that there are no slurs at all. And we don't add something, any slurs here. It will sound not so good. This is not very many modern flutists don't play it often, but it's more interesting to know how they did it. We begin from this one and then go to Handel Sonata and Bach Sonata. Because all these composers took these ideas from French music. So French music was the major style, and a lot of French tutors went to other countries, and it was very popular to listen to French musicians.
So, yeah, but those lines there. What do they mean on the second part of the bass line? You know, there's lines over top of the
lines.
Notes. Yeah, you know.
It belongs to harpsichord.
Yes, continued bass. Like, this means that you have to keep the same chord structure.
It's like it's the root of the chord?
Yes, like for example, like a six with a line.
Is it for right?
Yes, it's like six. You have to keep playing six on top.
All music goes. All music was written like this,
right.
So you see two lines. The first line, up line, is for flute, and down line is for left hand of harpsichord player, or for cello, for viola da gamba, or bassoon player. And these figures meant that which chords harpsichord player should put into it. They were always improvised.
Okay.
The next articulation is backstroke of our T. So T, we produce. I don't know. Some people do pronounce R from here, but it's necessary to do it here. I don't know about Poland. R? Can you speak R?
We are Belgian, so we do things differently than in Holland. You know?
Good. For Russians, there is no problem. For Greek people and for Italians, and in 18th century, I read in this. That French people also announce it in high society too. Now in some regions of France also. And for English people it's very difficult. So Thierry was also double toning of 18th century. In 18th century we didn't have double toning. The first time when it was described, it was treatise of Delius in 1795. He described daga. So daga is or tuku is very uniform staccato or detaché, which they didn't use at all because it was not the idea of baroque interpretation. When we play baroque music, we should not use staccato. The last one, double tuning, is diddle, which is the most difficult for producing. I wanted to ask to show Tilly first. You notice that this is not real frullato. I just used the first moment of her, and then we get the tdtdtd, and the second note must be long. So we start with her, and then we just continue and play one note. And the last one is diddle. It is very fast, much faster than tulu or tiri. I cannot play it very well. And the trome is another one, very famous flutist of composer of 18th century. He wrote also a thick book about how to play the flute. And he said in his book that you need half of year, every day practice during several hours, and then you achieve this staccato. On one note, I can do this. You notice that it's not real staccato. It's not hard, not short. It's middle between legato and staccato, modern staccato. It's almost all good, yeah? But I will try. And now we will. I would like to explain how it. We use this one, but opposite way. We have rest here, and we start with syllable 2, and then we pronounce 2, 2, 2. So each root will fall on the main beat, down beat, and T will fall on up beat. That's why we will have this inequality. Maybe I start modern flute. And I will show how it sounds your journal. Italian people played more than French musicians, but they were, it was mixture because some musicians went to Italy and Italians came for French and they copied each other. For example, Glavès, Michel Glavès sonatas. Michel Glavès is a French composer, but he wrote Italian music, Italian style music. Real French music is Couperin, Potter, Philippe, but half of Leclerc, some others, but not so. Okay.
So basically, it's not Thierry, but Riti.
Yes, so this is opposite. And it it's not works when we play Leclerc's jump. I would not play like this. But if I use this articulation, not staccato, but with differences, using of different syllables, we can change syllables. We can combine D, Re, T, Re, Diddle, T, Re, Diddle, very different. I will show you later in another book from France. But this part, first movement of partita, if I use this articulation, but not so sharp. I play unequal, and when I play, I play equal. And the same, I didn't do that score. The same you can use here.
Yeah, you make this mistake.
Don't read the notes. I will show you without. So usually I explain it like.